So we're going to talk about Frank Lloyd Wright this morning. And you know, Frank Lloyd Wright is, of course, the most famous architect in America. If you ask anybody, do you know the name of an architect, they will say Frank Lloyd Wright. There's also a reason for that. He designed many, many, many buildings. And of the some thousand some buildings he designed, over 500 actually were built. A huge accomplishment in any case. So we're going to look at Wright and very briefly, just in terms of his personal history. This is what he looked like when he came to Chicago from Wisconsin and found a job ultimately with Lewis Sullivan and the firm of Adler Sullivan. He considered Sullivan to be the most important and the most creative and gifted designer in Chicago. And Sullivan took a liking to him, and within a very short time, he became the head draftsman in the office and worked for Sullivan. There's what Sullivan looked like about 1900. They had a falling out, and Wright left the firm before 1900, but they remained in contact, and actually Wright referred to Sullivan as his Lieber Meister, as his beloved master through his entire life. And there's Wright about 1895 when he was 28 years old and a young married man in Oak Park. You probably know that his dates, or you may not know his dates, are 1867 to 1959. He died at age 92. This is the house that he built himself on the basis of a loan of $5,000 that he got from Lewis Sullivan when he and Kitty got married. Catherine Tobin is his wife. And this is Catherine Tobin. She was 18. Wright was 23. This is 1890 when they were photographed right here. This is Wright's mother, Anna Lloyd Wright, who lived next door. And you'll hear about that on tomorrow morning if you come to that session, and other members of his family. This is his sister, Maginot. So Wright was very well known for being an unusual architect, and probably the most revolutionary house that he did, at least in terms of public acknowledgement, during his period in Oak Park was the Robie House of 1906. Some of you may have seen it. It's very fortunate that the house has not been razed. There was a point where it might have been torn down, and there were some people that interfered with that, some people who had gone to college with the president of the University of Chicago and were able to say, you just can't be letting this happen. And fortunately, he listened to them. So now it's been in restoration, and it's almost completely restored, and it's quite beautiful, and you can visit it anytime you go to Chicago. Wright called this kind of house and the other houses that he did in Chicago at this time prairie houses, because he thought that they reflected the landscape of the prairie. And part of this had to do with horizontality. Part of it had to do with a certain kind of sense of spatiality, because he was really the first architect who ever defined architecture as being, first of all, about space, secondarily about form. The form is there in order to define the space. And so some of the things that we can see here, even in this picture, are about that space. And one of them is this huge cantilever that you see here. And there's another one at the other end. This is the living room end. The other end is the dining room end. Nobody had ever seen this kind of an extension out over a porch with no supports. And he did this by being one of the first people ever to use steel in the construction of the roof. So there are two steel channels that run 110 feet the length of this roof that permit this cantilever to actually exist as it does. The plan of the house reflected ideas of his too, that the house should be about fluid space. And you can see here, there are this sort of pochade area indicates where the overhangs are here. But you can see that in the living room, there is no real strong way of separating the space from the space of the dining room. And you actually come in at this lower level, you go upstairs that are in the midst of the fireplace, and you end up here, and this is a guest room. These are the kitchen and servants' quarters. But this idea of the extent, the horizontal extent, and the idea of the horizontality of the prairie, what he was talking about there. So there's the living room of the house. It had other important features, radiant heating, copper tubing in the floor for hot water so that there was no forced air, but the floors were always warm to walk on and bare feet. I would love that. And recessed lighting that you can see if you, this isn't probably the best picture to show it, but it's under here. He, of course, designed these light fixtures as well. He created, for Mr. Roby, extensive amounts of fenestration of windows, but they're all very private. He wanted a lot of light, a lot of air, but no loss of privacy. And so, of course, they're up overhead, and you can't see in, but they can see out. It's just very, very well done. Security for the children, the play yard was secured, and you could run in and out of the house and into the backyard without ever letting, the children could do that without ever getting in the way. And then the dining room table here really sort of stresses his notion about the family as community. I don't think chairs look very comfortable, but mostly people don't eat sort of leaning back. They eat leaning forward, at least I do. And this was really the idea that there was a, like almost like a little room inside of a larger room. And those were just ideas that he had about family life that he included in this design and in other Prairie House designs. He had designed well over 50 of these houses before 1909. And in 1909, as you may know, he suddenly closed his office, left his family of six children and wife at home, and ran off to Europe with the wife of one of his clients. I will talk about that again tomorrow morning in much greater depth. But when they came back, they could not live in Oak Park. Neither one, well, she had been divorced, she got divorced in 1911. He didn't get divorced until 1922. And that's a very long story that I'm not going to deal with right now. But he managed, after a series of events, including a horrible tragedy, to reestablish himself. And in the area of 1924, 1925, he had been contacted by a Chicago businessman named Gordon Strong, who had gotten very interested in Sugarloaf Mountain near Dickerson, Maryland. And he bought property there. And he said, you know, I want to create something that will, it was going to make money. It was about, you know, something that would draw people to it. And he said, I want to have an automobile objective. It's sort of an interesting name. We don't use those sorts of terms now. But the idea was that people would drive to this place in their cars, and then they would drive up it into the actual building itself. And there would be reasons to have, restaurants and other kinds of things. He thought that there could be a theater inside. In one of the early plans for this, Wright was considering a spire, which would be the place where a dirigible could dock. He decided later was really probably not the best plan, so he gave it up. But he then decided that he would create a planetarium on the inside, and that's what you see in the sectional drawing here, and also in this model that has been built more recently and obviously displayed in the Guggenheim Museum. And this would have been what people came to see as well as whatever the view from the top was. And there were two, this building was wrapped by actually two spirals, one for driving up and one for driving down. And then there was a third way of, let's see here. There we go. One for pedestrian access too. So you could, in fact, walk around. And originally, what Strong had wanted to do was to create a lot of parking space inside so that this would have been a smaller interior. Wright thought that was silly, and he decided he would have the parking be on the ramps. As you went up, you could just drive up to the point where there was a parking space and then park in it, and then walk around for the rest of your experience there. Well, it turns out that Gordon Strong didn't like this idea at all, and he rejected it out of hand, and that was the end of it. And he and Wright had words about it, and of course, Wright had words with many people about many things. But this was kind of the end. But it's the first time that he introduced something that wasn't kind of what one would have called Euclidean geometry in his work. His early work was about triangles and squares and cubes and you know, if you think about Unity Temple, many of you would know Unity Temple in Oak Park, or if you think about the Larkin Building that was built in Buffalo as a way for the Larkin Soap Company to organize all of the soap label coupons that were sent in. All of that was done in this kind of rectilinear style. And suddenly here it's a circle, and then not only a circle, but a spiral. And he really said this was, he called it a ziggurat. He said this is a kind of a recollection of something in the ancient Near East. And I'm not sure whether Gordon Strong thought that was what he wanted to get out of the design, but that's what Wright put into it. And since it was rejected, Wright didn't have the opportunity to really build it or to explore it any further. So as we would follow Wright's work, we discovered that that idea of the automobile objective really never went away. He developed at the end of the 1920s and into the 1930s a concept called Broadacre City. Broadacre City was really a way of sort of reorganizing urban and suburban life into something that one could call ex-urban, or the idea of having a decentralized kind of urban society. He didn't like the city. He was very much like many people in the 19th century who thought the city was evil and just in and of itself, although there's nothing he wanted to do more than to build in New York City. But he thought that the city was evil, and he thought, you know, there's enough land, we can decentralize commerce, decentralize transportation. People can have their own kind of helicopters to ride around in, and or their boats or whatever else. And there is the automobile objective appearing again all of a sudden in one of the drawings of Broadacre City. Decentralized tall buildings, part of the Broadacre concept was everybody would have 1 acre of land and you could build a house on that, and then you could grow vegetables and you could sustain yourself or trade with people, and there would be regional markets where you could take what you grew and trade with people there. And people used to sort of laugh about this, but actually more recent research has suggested that it wasn't such a scatterbrained idea, and that there actually it could have been done. I don't think it ever is going to be done, but it probably could have been done. So there's the objective with the red arrow there. And then as Wright moved on around this same general period, he was invited to suggest a design for the Church of St. Mark's in the Bowery. You can see the church here in this rendering. This church was a very socially conscious church, and they decided that they wanted to use their land to actually build affordable housing. And so they asked Wright to design it, and they were going to build 3 towers. This was going to be the first one, and Wright has projected it here, and I think that probably would have been this one that you see there. That whole idea fell through. They just could not finance it, I think partly because it was done in 1929, and probably the idea and the design were done before the stock market crash, and after the stock market crash, the whole thing was kaput. But what's interesting here to me is that his idea for this tower is one that really is almost something that spins. It's almost like a pinwheel. There is a core in the center, as I think we'll see in just a bit, that is the structure, because he liked this idea of having sort of what he called the taproot and then a concrete column, essentially, coming up the center with floors cantilevered off of that central column. And you can see that what he's designed here, or what he shows us, is 4 different levels that are part of this. And even though this is clearly it's a diagram about how the apartments work, if you look at the plan, you can't help but sense this pinwheel idea. And there's the concept with the shorter and wider cantilevers off of the central column, with the taproot going down into the ground, which we really don't see in this particular drawing. But it's kind of, to my mind, sort of the echo of this idea of something that turns. And I don't know whether he felt that way about it, of course, but it seems like it might be something that he could have seen that way. It's really not terribly far off in some ways from a much earlier work that he did. This is something that he did on his family's property in Spring Green. Oops, I have to go back here again. There we go. This was called the Romeo and Juliet Windmill. And you can see that there is this kind of sense that there are two pieces here, and they kind of work together, and they almost seem to have this kind of spinning quality, even though there's absolutely nothing about them that is circular or suggests a spiral. But it's kind of an idea that just kind of smoldered a little bit from earlier, this is 1896 when he did this, to 1929 and then on later. He also was interested in using the circle just in general. He didn't have lots of opportunities to use the circle, but when he had the opportunity, he did. This was a project that he did for Florida Southern College, which built a whole campus according to his design. And what you're looking at here is a dome of water, which for a while was out of commission, but has been restored. So this is a more recent photograph, but you can see that he's using circular elements here in a few places. He uses some other things too. There's a hexagon here, and there are some other sort of partial forms like that, even the semicircle of what you see here around this particular, this building. But in his project for the library, he began to introduce a very large circular plan. This is the Rue Library of Florida Southern, and you can see that he contrasts this circular element with the more rectilinear element here, with also a certain kind of triangular element in the gable over this particular space. And it's kind of interesting to see this because while it's just one story, the building is very, it sort of forcefully projects itself out of the accompanying volume of this taller part. And then when you look inside, everything is spinning around the librarian's desk. I know a lot of librarians would really like that. But I'm not sure whether all of the students like that, but in any case, this idea that you have the circular building and things can sort of turn around that center axis, which makes, of course, complete logical sense, is something that not very many people were dealing with. Circular buildings, we don't see a lot of circular buildings in the history of modern architecture. So that's kind of where some of these ideas may have, managed to survive a little bit. But by 1947, he had been asked to design a self-service garage for Pittsburgh. And I think that he probably got this commission on the basis of his relationship to the Kaufman family, who built Falling Water 10 years earlier. And what we see here, again, is now the idea of a spiral. And at this point, it has the relationship to the strong automobile objective because of the car. Now, Wright was absolutely in love with the automobile. He collected them, and he drove them, and loved to have convertibles with the top down, and he loved Cherokee red. It was his favorite color, and would have Cherokee red convertibles. So I think it's an interesting thing to discover that he's using the need to have automobile self-servicing garage. I mean, it's self-service because you park yourself. It's not about being repaired or anything like that. But he must have thought, well, it would really be fun to drive up and down these ramps. And I'm not sure I feel that way about driving in that kind of a structure, but he did. But maybe if I could drive up and down one that Wright had designed, it would be different. Maybe I'd think, this is not so bad. But this project did not get anywhere, and once again, nothing really came of it. He tried it later. Here is Point Park Civic Center in Pittsburgh. Again, another Pittsburgh commission, probably again mediated by the Kaufmans, or in some way or other related to his work for the Kaufmans. And you can see that here again, he has this same idea. And there is the plan that he had for it. And you might think, well, that just kind of looks like somebody just took a compass and just drew all kinds of things. But in fact, there's method to his madness. There is the exterior form. You know, that's the outline of the main building that we're looking at there. But these are spaces on the inside. And again, you know, this is a civic center, so it probably was meant to have various kinds of functions in it for exhibits and large concerts, maybe that sort of thing. And if you see the section through it, here is what he's done. It's exactly the same thing that he did when he did the automobile objective for Gordon Strong. He had these smaller and eventually larger domical forms in the midst of this enwrapping spiral. And you know, once again, we're looking at something that didn't get built. I'm not sure whether this was any more frustrating to him than any of the other commissions that he designed that didn't get built. But it's interesting to me that he never gave up the notion that he first had with the automobile objective for Gordon Strong. Because for some reason or other, he decided that it didn't work. He thought, of course it would work. Somebody's going to be smart enough to actually build one of these, and then we'll prove that it can work. So this was one of a number of projects that he did for Pittsburgh that did not get built. It's interesting. Pittsburgh could have been one of the major Frank Lloyd Wright cities if you count the number of commissions that he got there that he hoped to build but didn't build. And that's just, you know, I guess you'd have to say that's the way the cookie crumbles, but there may be more to it than that as well. So in this same period, 1948, 1949, in the 40s, the V.C. Morris gift shop approached him and they said, we want to remodel a building on Maiden Lane in San Francisco. Very fashionable shopping district, and we want you to design it. And he said, of course you do, and I will. And so this is the facade of the building that he designed, and I think probably a very surprising design since it has absolutely no windows in it except for the glass around the opening, which we'll see in just a moment, which is actually a glass tunnel going into the building. There is a drawing that he did of the Maiden Lane facade. All of these are light fixtures along here and also up there. And then as you look at the plan here, and we'll look at it, I think, in slightly larger format in just a moment, what you may see is if you go in through the door here, you actually come into a place where there is a ramp that goes up and encircles the interior. And so finally, he got to build a spiral ramp that at that time was really nothing more than an overlook. You could see what was on display down below here. It was a fine china, crystalware, that sort of thing, silverware, place settings. And in the current usage, it's an art gallery. And so now, I think I have a picture here in just a moment, but you can see works of art hanging on the wall here. So it's more than simply a way of getting up to the next level. Yeah, there we go. You can see some of these works of art that are hanging there and up above, too. And I think it's a perfectly good art gallery and perfectly good usage. So he finally had this opportunity to see what it was like to actually use a spiral, but of course, no automobile, which may have been the biggest problem that he never thought about using the spiral without an automobile until this particular commission where there was no need to worry about the automobile. And there you see the entrance. I guess I could have put this slide earlier, but there you see the entrance into this space. coming in underneath the spiral as it sweeps up. It's really, I think, quite an amazing interior for such a small building. But of course, that was one of his great gifts, was he was able to take small spaces and make them seem much, much larger than they were, partly by contrast and partly by how spaces related, or parts of spaces related to other parts of spaces. So I think that's kind of what's happening here. I brought this in just to kind of remind you that this kind of arch was not something that he invented. There is Sullivan's bank in Sydney, Ohio, which some of you may know. Sullivan, in the period after 1900, after Adler had left him, and when he was really in his declining career, built a number of banks in small towns in the Midwest, in Ohio and in Minnesota and in Iowa. And this is the one in Sydney, Ohio, just north of Oxford by about 100 miles. And this arch used here actually derives from Henry Hobson Richardson. So there is a kind of a tradition of American architecture back to Richardson in the late 19th century of using this kind of arch that almost starts its springing at the ground. This is the spring line actually for this one, but it's almost there. And the same kind of thing happening here. So he's simply updated it. In 1952, he designed a house for his son, David Lloyd Wright, in Phoenix, which I'm sure all of you are aware of has been the object of a huge controversy in the last year because a developer had purchased it and wanted to tear it down so that he could create a housing development. They decided that it was taking up too much space on the site and that they could get rid of it. And ultimately, it has been saved. So it is going to be restored. I think it needs a little bit of restoration. But this is, a first use of the spiral in a residential building. So if we look here, you can see, let me go back to the plan a minute. What happens is that you can come into this courtyard, but you walk up the spiral, up the ramp this direction, and you enter the house here. You can also come up this way if you want to. And then there's the living room, and this is the bedroom wing, and they have overlooks and into the courtyard and outside and so forth. But the idea is that you really you come up and enter the house on this circular ramp, which is also kind of visible there. This is where you would enter. You would come up, and we're looking underneath the underneath side of that ramp, and then there's the rest of the house there. And this is looking across the courtyard at what is to be seen directly on. There is the ramp, and you can see that this house is done in concrete block. And here again, this is probably not standard concrete block ordered from a factory, but probably was cast on site. It's kind of the end of what he called the Usonian automatic, which was a kind of a concrete block house that he built where he cast all of the individual blocks on site, and they included ornamentation and other kinds of things that were part of his design. So I can't imagine him ever, ordering cinder blocks to build a house with. He would cast everything himself, and that's what we're looking at there. You can see there's another spiral here that goes up to the roof. So there's actually two different spirals, and I think that that's really a significant thing too. There you see it again. And I think what's interesting about this house is that it actually looks bigger than it is when you actually get up close to it. It's a smaller building in some ways than you expect it to be. I mean, look at the size of the people here and the size of the house. And I don't know, maybe David Wright was short like his father, and he always, Fred always used himself as the judge of scale. Well, it's a bit tall enough for me, So that may be why we have what we have here. But in any case, this is the interior. And here again, you see the size of this person. It's a low ceiling, and if this door is 6'8" or maybe even 7 feet, that's still a pretty low ceiling. He designed the rug, which is something like the plan of the house, although not identical to it. And then if you look carefully, you see that the hearth is surrounded by what seems to be a piece of something that has a spiral quality to it, just slightly, just hinted at in the way the blocks overhang here. So this was probably the most complete use of the spiral, the most complex use of the spiral that he had done in a small building like this. And he kept doing them. This is a house that he designed for Mrs. Daniel Donahoe in Phoenix. She bought this site, and it had already been owned by somebody who shaved the top of the mountain off. You know, Wright always said, a house should never be on a hill, it should be of a hill. It should never, somehow it will destroy the hill if we build it up on top. We have to build it into the hill. And so he said, well, it's already been destroyed, so, you know, what the heck, I'll just do what I want to do here. And what's happening, of course, we drive up a ramp drive, and then when we get to the house, we walk up another ramp here. So he's found a way to use the car and pedestrian movement to justify the spiral. And this is the plan. Mrs. Donahue actually had, I think you can see there, one of two other houses on the site for each of her sons. I just can't even imagine what that was about. But in any case, she was ready to go, and then Wright died. And she said, I will not build this house. You know, first of all, he won't be here to manage the construction, but I just don't want to pursue this anymore. I had a relationship with him that was important to me, and that's the way it goes. So that all of that is an interesting issue, but you must be aware, as I've showed you all of these things, that something else was going on in his career at this same time that was even more important, and that was that in 1943, Hilary Bay, who was the curator of the Museum of Non-Objective Painting and its parent organization, the Solomon R. Guggenheim Foundation, asked Wright to come to New York. And she said in a letter to him, I do not think these paintings in the Guggenheim collection, in the Solomon Guggenheim collection, are easel paintings. They are order creating order and are sensitive, even corrective to space. As you feel the ground, the sky, and the in-between, you will perhaps feel them too and find the way. I need a fighter. I need a lover of space, an originator, a tester, and a wise man. Your three books, which I am now reading, gave me the feeling that no one else would do. I want a temple of spirit, a monument. Oh, she couldn't have said anything he would have loved more than to hear than that. Oh, my. He said, here I am. I can do it all for you. And so the result of this was the Guggenheim, which opened after Frank Lloyd Wright's death in 1959. You can see the crowds of people here on the street. There's the ribbon cutting. There's his third wife, Olga Vanna. With other people in the family, and with Robert Wagner, the mayor of New York, and Harry Guggenheim, the son of Solomon R. Guggenheim. And so the question here is, how did this come into being from Hilary Bay to this? Well, the concept of the museum, as you probably know, how many of you have been to the Guggenheim? Good number of hands, so I'm not telling you anything new here. The concept is that when you enter, you go up in an elevator to the top of the, the top floor on the number of floors that the elevator touches, and then you walk down a long spiral ramp that keeps going around that central space until you get down to the bottom of the ground, to the ground level. The ramp is, of course, the principal exhibit space. It's not the only exhibit space, but it's the principal exhibit space. And it permits a kind of an easy stroll because you're not going up, you're going down. And you are looking at the works of art that are displayed along that way. And some of them are in between the structural supports and some of them are displayed on the structural supports. So I think the thing that most people recognize is that this concept is the essence of that design, but also the source of all the controversies about it. And it really was a very complex process of design and redesign and compromise. But Wright did many different possible designs. And you know, I think that if you read the history of falling water, and some of you may have read Falling Water Rising or some of the other books that include discussions of falling water, you know that it seemed as though this building came out of him like Zeus being, or Athena being born out of the head of Zeus by parthenogenesis. It just kind of was all there and it just kind of happened. And you get the idea that he never had to develop an idea and test it and change it and compare it and all that sort of thing the way we force our students to do in school. But he did. And this is a proof of that, because here is the first version of this building. And you can see that there is this spiral. I don't know whether he really intended to have this kind of candy pink color on the outside. It may just have been a rendering technique. But this was his first idea. And there were problems with it. And so he kind of reviewed it. And this is kind of the more, I guess we could say, the more realistic version of it. In this drawing. Again, the color is something that I don't think anybody is exactly sure about what that meant. But there you see this spiral with a dome on top of two forms that we've seen again and again in these buildings. And down below an auditorium, below grade. And then if we look carefully, we see the concept here of going up, and here he has you know, the possibility of walking, you know, off of the ramp at various places, and we don't really see the elevator here, but there's a kind of a sense that you could walk up, and some of the ideas are not completely worked out yet, but this idea was presented to the city of New York, and they said. The building inspector said, you have 32 code violations here. And you know, you're not going to get a permit to build. And you also, we don't know whether this is going to work the way you say it's going to work. You see, when we look at these drawings, we don't really know exactly how this spiral is going to be held up. And he had, he had plans that indicated that, but it was, they said, we never have seen a building like this before. And it turns out that he had a distant cousin who was a very important person in New York, Robert Moses, the city planner that you may have heard of. He was a very controversial city planner. And he tried to intervene and didn't really succeed in intervening. I mean, you can't just walk in, even if you're the most powerful city planner, and say, give him a permit. I mean, there have to be, there are rules. So he came up with some other ideas. Here he's decided to invert the spiral and to see it be bigger at the bottom than at the top. And you can see that he's done that in sort of two different ways here. And everything that's up here is much different now. We sort of have some angular pieces that project out from the elevator tower. And this also did not succeed in solving all the problems. Scheme C, he decided not to have a spiral at all. So I'm just going to have it be a hexagon, and you just get off at every floor and see it, and then get on the elevator and go back up. Well, he didn't probably really like that, and I don't suppose that Hill or Rebe liked it very much either. So he came up in 1945 then, so this is 2 years after he had started working on it, with what he called the modern gallery scheme. And if you look at this, he'll say, well, that's pretty much what the Guggenheim looks like. Well, what's wrong with this picture? If you know where the, if you remember the Guggenheim, what are you going to say? It's flipped. Yeah, this is, the ramp is on the other end of the block, yes. So we'll have to see how that comes about. But in any case, he really worked hard with this, and this is really the idea that finally solved most of the structural problems, even though at the very end they still didn't know that he, they still said, you haven't proved to us that this building is going to stand up. But he said, and you haven't proved to me that it won't. So they gave him the building permit, and with this, he also, of course, made a very, or had his interns make a very extensive model of what this was all going to be like. And this is kind of a diagrammatic plan that probably helped explain it to the public in general. He was planning to have a dome on the top that was done in glass tubing, and they said, no way. Right now, this already violates code, because if there was a fire at the, on the bottom here, all that smoke would go up to the top, and if there was heat, it would just melt those tubes. You're not going to do this. And so he came up ultimately, as we'll see, with a different idea. But he had already used this kind of roof in the Johnson Wax Administration Building in Racine, and that's what you're looking at here. This is kind of the version that he was thinking about putting on top of the Guggenheim until they said no. He also used or wanted to use glass tubing around all of the fenestration that is in this, these very tight little places at the top of the of each one of the walls that are the parapets of the outside of the spiral, and that didn't get to be done either. That was also nixed. Now, there's Wright, there's Solomon Guggenheim, there's Hillary Bay, and I think she's looking triumphant here, because they finally have gotten something that everybody has pretty much agreed is going to be it, even though there were still changes that had to be made. And this is then called the revised modern gallery scheme, 1951-1954. So 9 years before this building actually was designed and construction could start. And of course, this is pretty much the way we remember the Guggenheim now. This is not exactly the way this piece ended up, as we'll see, but it's the place where that sort of piece goes. This is probably still a little bit farther uptown. It should be a little bit farther downtown, but it's still, you know, we can still argue this is pretty much the way that the building is today. You can see here, if you look carefully, that what he created with these tall kind of what you could call flanges, or they're triangular pieces, and they are steel reinforced concrete that actually are what hold the pieces, or the spiral in place and support it. I keep doing the wrong thing here, don't I? You can see here the way when you come in, this is where the elevator is, and you can go up to the top and then walk down. All of that works pretty well. And there's one of his famous renderings of the building at night. He loved to do these nightmare renderings. If you've ever seen any of them, and particularly in color, they're just gorgeous. They must have been done with tempera paint or something, because it's not a watercolor technique. You have a black board and the little dots that indicate the light, and they're in like bright yellow and bright orange and bright white, and that's kind of what you see here. It's unfortunate to see this all in black and white only. Well, okay, so this whole concept of the museum was very controversial, not just to the city of New York, but to the art community. And the person who was supposed to be curating the museum said, this is just nuts. I'm not gonna be able to hang anything here that isn't crazy, because do I hang it like this and people are standing like this, or do I hang it like this and have it look like it doesn't match the building? And you know, look how Wright does this. He says, everybody's looking at the masterpiece. He's acting as though this is not slanted at all. Maybe this is slanted. This kind of looks like people are sitting here and kind of, you know, on a slight slope, but not the painting, or over here. And then he says, oh, well, you know, we'll have other kinds of things to hang paintings on that we can move around and that sort of thing. Well, you know, he was just sort of ignoring what the curators were saying. And then there was a whole group of artists who said, who signed a letter and saying, we've sent to the New York Times, said, this is the worst thing that you can possibly do to modern art. This is horrible. He doesn't know what he's doing. He's crazy. And he just, you know, Wright just kind of laughed it off and went on. And this is the ultimate design in 56, 58, with the way that, this is exactly the way the building looks today. Everything that we see here is what we get, and that you can see in this black and white photograph that that's true. And This is the way they solved the problem of the dome on the roof. You can see that it actually comes from the support for it comes from the structure of these triangular flanges, or you could call them wedges, if you will, that actually support the ramp. The ramp is larger at the top than at the bottom because he figured people would go down the ramp at different rates of speed as they walked, and so you could needed more space at the top where more people might be at once, and then it would kind of filter out as it went down. And this is the west facade on Fifth Avenue as it looked maybe 6 years ago. There's been a restoration of the exterior in the meantime. And this is this secondary space here. It is slightly centralized. It has some exhibition space in it, and down below it's the bookstore and gallery. That is the gift shop and gallery of gifts. And that's what you're looking at here. And then if you look at this, you can see that one of the things that the building accomplished was to call attention to itself by being so absolutely different from anything around it. Now, that's not something that's peculiar to Frank Lloyd Wright. Most modern architecture has a resistant quality. It wants to resist what already exists in order to prove its difference and its newness and so forth. But Wright was really good at that, and this is partly why he was so happy to have this site on Fifth Avenue. Did I say he wanted to build in New York? Yeah. So we have lots of different views of it here from Fifth Avenue and from the park and so forth, and you can see that this isn't the first time that renovation has taken place on the exterior. Here's when we go inside, we see what it looks like when people walk in, and of course they get their cameras out and take pictures of what's up above. And this is, of course, what that dome looks like now. And then the real question is, so what is this about? What's happening here? And in order to, I think, make sense out of this, we need to see a number of things. By the way, I think she wore her Guggenheim hat. Don't you think? We need to know that this was the kind of painting that had been collected by Solomon R. Guggenheim, or by the foundation and on his behalf. This is a painting by Vasily Kandinsky, okay, Russian artist. He actually is considered to be the inventor of abstract art. Piet Mondrian, a painting done in 1921, Dutch painter, very heavily influenced by Wright in some ways, although that you wouldn't necessarily know that from this particular painting. Achille Gorky, this painting called Water of the Flowery Mill, 1944. Or Willem de Kooning's 1950 painting that you see here. Now, what do these paintings have in common, and what are they about? Well, you remember Hilda Rebay said, these paintings in our collection are very sensitive, even corrective to space. Wright said he didn't like this kind of art, but in fact, whether he really did or didn't like it, he created a work that actually fulfills the kind of idea that this painting projects, and also what some other movements in the 20th century began to project about architectural space. This is a design for what's called the Monument of the Third International by Vladimir Tatlin. It was going to be built in Moscow. This was going to be the world headquarters of the Communist Party after the Russian Revolution. And it's done in a style that we generally call constructivism. And the idea here is that it is called that because it is an assemblage of parts. It's not, the idea for this is not that you have a, the idea of a block of stone that you either carve on the outside or carve on the inside, and you take away what you don't need. The idea is that you have different kinds of materials that you construct and assemble together, and you create the space that way. It's a very different concept for building a building or making a sculpture. And one could argue this is a very sculptural building. Guess what? It has a spiral on it. I don't know that Wright ever knew about this design. I'm not suggesting that he took it from this in any way, shape, or form. But it's a non-historicizing use of the spiral, as his were, at least after the Gordon Strong automobile objective. There's no reference to the automobile here. But there were time relationships expressed by the solid geometric forms here, the ones that you see in here. They rotated in differential ways. One of them rotated once a day, smallest one. The next biggest one rotated once a month, and the largest one rotated once a year. So that no matter when you saw this building, during the day or during the year, it was always in a slightly different configuration, or would have been. Now, it didn't get built, and there are reasons for this. The first one is that it would have been approximately the same height as the World Trade Center. That is, in and of itself, not the reason. The reason is that nobody was able to calculate a structure like this at that time. Number two, there was not enough steel production facility in Soviet Russia to put out this much steel for a building like this. And number three, they couldn't afford it. I mean, after the revolution, they were not a wealthy nation by any manner of means. Number four, there's another reason too, and that is that the Soviet government did not trust the constructivists, all of whom supported the revolution. And so what did they do? They ended up building a very, very sort of neoclassical building. I mean, I thought you didn't want this stuff, you know? Well, anyway. But I only say this because this idea of time and space, of course, is the essence of the early 20th century, of Einstein, of the whole question about the splitting of the atom, the whole question about all kinds of other time-space relationships, or if we look at the writing of James Joyce. I mean, all of these things make sense together. And what we probably don't recognize when we go in here, but we can recognize, is that we see these people in these different places, these here are people here and people down here, there, 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 and they're all standing on the same plane. And one of them will be over another one, but they're on the same plane. And this relativistic issue here is one that is also constantly changing as you move, you change your position, you run around the building. And this notion that the space is not just something flat and has, you know, it's right, left, up, down, back and forth, this is really more of the kind of space that we actually find in these paintings, which is a lot like the Jetsons space. And I use the Jetsons cautiously here because there's not anything about them, except that if you remember the Jetsons, they have their spaceship and they can go like this and then suddenly that's the orientation, or they can go like this and suddenly that's the orientation, or they can turn upside down, that's the orientation. Whatever way they go in this outer space that they're in, they orient themselves. And I think that this is really what Wright's museum is about. I think that it's about, I think the spiral gave him an opportunity to actually reflect the kind of space that was in these paintings that Hilary Bay was, they must have had long conversations about it. And I think that he grasped this, and she probably continued to push him in this direction as well, but that only the spiral would have answered the need that he had in terms of trying to accommodate this collection of paintings. And as it's turned out, you know, nobody doesn't go to the, it sounds like Sara Lee doesn't, nobody doesn't like Sara Lee. Nobody doesn't go to the museum, the Guggenheim Museum, because they don't like the fact that the paintings might not exactly be one way or the other. And there are all kinds of other ways to display the paintings, and they display sculpture, they display a lot of other things too. The one thing that one can argue about with this is that he actually is the person who created the first of what we would now call the first signature museum. And by that I mean that a lot of times you go there to see the museum as much as you may go to see the show that's in it. And they do, of course, have a large permanent collection, and the Guggenheim Foundation is very well aware of the marketing advantage that they had when Wright got this museum built. And of course, where have they built since then? They've built in Spain. They have built many other museums. I mean, the Guggenheim Foundation is in many different countries, and they have always tried to find a cutting-edge architect to give them a design for a building that will be absolutely unique and will essentially be as much of a destination as whatever is on display in those in the building itself. So I think that as we move away from the mid-20th century when this building was finished, 1959 it was finished, we will increasingly look back at it and say this was much more than what anybody thought it was at that time. And it will be as much a document of its own time as many other buildings that we could name throughout the history of architecture in Western civilization, let alone world civilization, that have taken a major place in terms of defining what a culture was all about. So that's what I have to say about this. I don't know whether you have questions or not. I would love to answer questions if I could. Yes. I think that that was done in the late 1920s. It was one of the periods when he didn't have a lot of work, and he would have been happy to design a filling station just to have some work. And you know, after the Taliesin tragedy, Wright was in Japan doing the Imperial Hotel from 1916 to 22. And then came back and was at Taliesin again, but he really had been out of sight. I mean, he wasn't in the public eye, and he tried to get some commissions and didn't get them. And when he could get a small one, he was very, very happy to take anything just to survive. Right, right. No, I'm glad that it is. But that's probably the period when he did it. Yeah.
I was struck in the photograph of the Sun House in Phoenix, you mentioned the Imperial Hotel, how much the carpet resembles his pattern from China.
Yeah, I didn't bring any of the China patterns in. I probably should have done that. Let's see if we can get back here. We actually showed a lot of slides here, didn't we? There it was. Right, right. Well, you know, it's interesting that you bring that up because there are so many things that are consistent ideas throughout his whole career. And it wasn't a linear progression where he said, well, we do this and now we do that and we do that. I mean, yes, he didn't design prairie houses in the 1940s, but the Usonian house was absolutely derived from the prairie house. And you could, you know, dealt with circles in a number of ways, particularly in graphic design, as in the case of the China for the Imperial Hotel, as much as for this rug, let alone the house itself. And so, you know, I don't know where the idea of the spiral came to him. You know, the fact that he talks about it as being a ziggurat with the Gordon Strong design may relate to the fact that he seemed to find a lot of energy in what he thought of as primitive cultures. I mean, that was a term that people used then that we don't use anymore. We don't call any culture primitive. Pre-Columbian would be a better term because he seemed to know quite a bit about Mexican design, although we have no evidence that he ever went to Mexico. And maybe he just saw pictures. We don't know. But he seemed to feel that way about Japanese design, although what is Japanese about Japanese design never got absorbed into his work. I mean, the Japanese would say, this is nothing Japanese about this. It's right. W-R-I-G-H-T, right. That's an interesting point. Now, Dick?
Well, I think his mother was strictly more world trip. He was young. He got very inspired with Japanese. And then there's a home. It's a Springfield. Nobody from Ohio has seen that. It's north, southeast corner. It's beautiful. It was turned into a boarding house. And these people took all the windows out and put it in the garage and they saved everything.
Uh-huh.
So they were lucky. They had the original pieces. They could bring it back in.
And this was where in Ohio?
In Springfield,
Ohio. Oh, in Springfield. Oh, yeah. Then, of course, that's been restored now. Right,
right.
Right. Right, yeah, it is beautiful. It's a conference center now, I believe. Yeah. Yes.
What is the tragedy that happened to him? Am I the only one who doesn't know?
come to the presentation tomorrow and I'll tell you all about it. Well, the short version of it is that he had installed this woman, Mema Cheney, as they say, in Taliesin, and she had been divorced from her husband since 1911, but the children had visiting rights, or she had visiting rights to have the children join her. And in 1914, in August, they were with her, and there was a servant in the house who was angry. He was from Barbados and was angry or had been insulted, or nobody's really quite sure. There are a lot of stories that float around and nobody has a real absolute explanation. He was hired to be a housekeeper and also to serve food and kind of be like a butler. And the morning of August 15th, Saturday morning, he served Mema Cheney and her two children their lunch on the porch, and then brought out an axe and bashed her skull open, killed the little boy the same way. The little girl screamed and ran, and he managed to get her and did not kill her, but severely injured her, so she would have been in agony. And then went and served the workers in the house, that is the apprentices and the people who were eating lunch in a different place. And while they were eating, he poured gasoline on the porch and lit the house on fire, and the whole house burned. Some of them escaped, a lot of them did not. And he was out axing the ones that he could get to before they. Well, I'll tell you even more tomorrow. But it's it was a horrible, horrible event. But you have to see it in a larger context, and the larger context is all of the different women that he was involved with, and how this particular relationship played out, and what that meant to him and to his work and so forth. So. Well, thank you very much.